going to take you right back to 1400, when the Han people lived in this area of China, the Lurs Plateau. This was a highly fertile, arable piece of land. And in 1420, the emperor moved the people to the Beijing area. And what I'm going to examine is why this happened. The ecosystems provided by that area are today looking like this. All of the fertile soil washed into the river, which was called the Mother River, mother of the Han people, came to be known as the Yellow River because of the desert sand now being blown into it. So those ecosystems no longer able to deliver for the people of China at that time. The Chinese people had the option of moving to another piece of land. My suggestion is that with 9 billion people we're headed for on the planet, we no longer have such an option. So we need to manage our global ecosystem services. The reason is the people are living longer. The massive successes of the 20th century, we nearly doubled life expectancy in that period of time. But the follow-through of all that, those advances, are that many more people are now living on the planet, 6.7 billion today, and one of them is calling me now. And this massive population means that we are headed into a situation where already we are consuming our ecosystems faster than they are being naturally replenished. So one of the big challenges I want to represent is that how we operate land, sea, water, and atmosphere is extraordinarily damaging for future generations. How are we going to get a grip on that? The oceans, for example, are half the lungs of the planet. Maintaining oxygen levels and carbon dioxide levels are dependent on them and on the forests. This is the state of the other set of lungs. If you had lung cancer, it would look something like this. We have reduced the active area of the forests, and we're continuing to do that. And there is a big part of our ecosystems on the wane as we move forward in time. If we look at this, it is a question of management. Here in Mato Grosso in South America, the people simply remove the forest in order to extend cattle farming. They farm at one animal per hectare, the lowest density in the world, because they can simply grab land by deforestation. The economic driver hasn't taken into account the cost of the ecosystems that those people are using. So as we move forward, the question is, have we got the technology to manage to understand how to retain our ecosystems and restore them? And have we got the political nous and ability to take on board these global challenges? This is a copper mine in Chile. Copper is a natural resource which is being mined, of course, far faster than it can be replenished. And it's a resource that exists in only a few countries in the world. The competition for these resources will create problems. And here's the granddaddy challenge of them all, climate change. Technically, we know what the impacts of climate change are going to be. This is a cast back in time, 60 million years. We can restore the planet to a temperature 12 degrees centigrade higher than it is today, unless we manage the way in which we use fuel on the planet. This is a good part of the story. About 15 years ago, the Chinese decided to restore the Lurs Plateau. An area the size of Belgium now looks like this. They have reforested it, they are terracing it, and they are creating new arable land at an enormous rate. The Chinese president announced before Copenhagen that the full Lurs Plateau will be completed by 2020. That's the size of France. This is an astonishing piece of work. This actually has also been repeated in Rwanda in Africa. What you see here is one of the hills of Rwanda being recovered through terracing learnt from the Chinese. This is being recovered at a rate of 5,000 hectares a year, adding that amount of arable land into this very densely populated part of Africa. Solutions are available. Here in Rwanda, is a political system able to accept them? But many of the solutions will require global cooperation. And the question then is, have we got the global governance procedures fit for purpose for the 21st century? These challenges are all interactive. And we will have to have classy management of them if we're going to proceed to preserve our 21st century for future generations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David.